us, you present this object, you say banana, 99% probability. Good, that's a good lady. Now you present this thing, and it answers toaster. Why? Because another perverse team of scientists, I'm here, another perverse team of scientists has added a patch, a sticker. He put this sticker on the table, and this sticker has been designed very carefully by training another from another machine for hours and hours in such a way that it will fool the original neural network. And so because of the presence of the patch, you can no longer identify the banana. This is very bad. Because imagine now that you are in a self-driving car. It has been very well trained. It identifies the stop sign and so on. But some guy, at some point, puts a sticker on the stop sign. And maybe your car sees this thing and says, oh, that is a story. Maybe it's pizza. Well, this is a bit dangerous. And I think that it is, well, at the moment, in terms of practical application, it's certainly one of the limitations. And this question of the fact that you don't really know what is happening. I mean, so the previous examples of the panda clearly show that many machines are not doing the same thing as our visual cortex. Certainly not. But the fact that it can be fooled this way, this is a serious issue. And in terms of using it for practical applications, I think it's probably a major problem. Let me go to the third limitation, the fact that there is no general intelligence. But if I go back to the sticker on the stop sign, which is now seen as a toaster, an intelligent analysis of the scene, of an intelligent machine would be surprised and start to ask questions. Say, okay, why is a toaster? That's not possible. That's nonsense. Okay, first of all, I slow down, I stop, and I analyze the situation. That's not what is happening. I mean, at the moment, what we have in our neural networks, they are very smart. I show you all the smart things they can do. But they are machines that solve very specific problems, very well posed, very well defined, and with very simple measure of performance. So that's another limitation. It brings me to my fifth and last chapter, which is discussing a bit superficially, but that's what I can do in this time that we have, a little bit what is intelligence. And I mean, that's a very complicated topic. Philosophers have been discussing that for many years. I mean, just one aspect of it, which is scientific intelligence. Intelligence that we apply in science. I decided to take this angle because I think that I know a little bit more about that intelligence than other type of intelligence. Actually, I was challenged to think about that by an article in 2008, which appeared in Wired by Chris Anderson. The title was The End of Theory, the Data Deluge Makes the Scientific Method Obsolete. Faced with this massive data, the traditional approach to science, hypothesized model test, is becoming obsolete. The new availability of huge amounts of data, along with the statistical tools to crunch these numbers, offers a whole new way of understanding the world. Correlation supersedes causation, and science can advance even without coherent models, unified theories, or really any mechanistic explanation at all. Well, for us, this is what scientists in the audience have used. I mean, it's no longer just you playing with pandas, gibbons, bananas, and so on, but it's Galileo himself who is being attacked now. It's not only scientific method. And so, let me try to show you the reasoning, and try to explain you what is the difference. And imagine the following experiment. Imagine that you have an experimentalist which does a lot of experiments of throwing objects into the air and looking at the trajectory, and with a video camera you can feed that on the input of a neural network, and you have a lot of data. In the data you measure the size of the object, the initial velocity, the angle, the speed, etc. And you ask the neural network to predict where it will fall. Simple enough predictions, it falls very well into the range of what, in principle, it's a well-defined task, well-defined objective. So, probably it's a flawed experiment, but I guess that if one would spend enough time on it, one could find a deep network, which, after being well-trained, it would be able to give good predictions. You give it the mass, you give it the initial velocity, the initial rotation, the shape, etc., velocity of the wind, all kinds of parameters, it will predict where the object falls back and forth. Maybe it could do that as good as the science, what the scientists would do, which is solving Newton's equation. So that's really the challenge. Which one is best, the deep network or the physicist? Well, you know what they will answer. The physicist uses a scientific model, separated over centuries now. The scientific model is a compact representation, and this compact representation is going to be decomposed into modules. The core module would be gravity and Newton's law. Okay? From that, you would predict that the object has a parabolic trajectory. That's what you learn the first year, or you learn it whenever you like in high school. And then you add the effect of friction from the air. Maybe if you're smart, you have a moving rotating object, you will add the magnetic force, which is the one that the tennis players are using to modify the trajectory of the ball. And basically, here you see the scientific intelligence at work. It uses these modules, these models, and these modules, and it combines them. And it adds them more and more in a more and more sophisticated way. And this composition of elementary laws can be then applicable in a different context. See, once I have that, I can use the same law to determine how an object moves if I am in another fluid, with a different law of friction, with a different constant of friction. I can use it in very different circumstances. If I am smart enough, I will understand that there is the law of gravity is also the one that applies to the movement of planets. So it's a completely much more general setup of being able to combine the models and to apply them in different contexts. And that is how scientific intelligence is working. It's much more than just predicting the trajectory and the impact point. So the lesson is that deep networks, they are very smart, but they have no reasoning, no representation of the world, no consciousness, no perception, no possibility to apply knowledge in different contexts or to combine it with other information. So we are very, very far from the go some people which is to have general artificial intelligence, the one that would be, you know, that would be the mythic one in which you have an artificial intelligence which is which takes full power on us. Whoever found that. So but we also see, and then to be fair, I should mention that what we have witnessed is a kind of drift of what we call intelligence in some sense. That is, I am more and more putting more and more pressure on what is intelligence. Maybe a few years ago people would have said, well, you know, playing chess, a good chess player is an intelligent person, he is able to play. Now we start to say, okay, playing chess is well defined rule, it's complicated and so on. But it's not so much of an intelligent behavior in the sense that I was mentioning before, that you have this module, you can apply it in other circumstances and so on and so forth. So we have this drift. So as a conclusion, I wanted to I'm sure that you will ask me the question, so now what is going to happen with all that? That's why I prefer to answer it now. Predicting the future is probably difficult. These are just a few statements made by illustrious predecessors. They all failed miserably, and I will certainly do the same now in front of you, but I will nevertheless try to point out what is the situation. What will happen? Well, image analysis, language processing, recommendation systems, these are very specific problems, well posed with a simple measure of performance, and this is clear that we have these problems that we have seen, it will go on. And it is based on the ability of AI to detect subtle patterns in massive amounts of data, with major technological breakthrough. It is also something that is very impressive, it is a global evolution, extremely fast. If you think about this, if you go back to one of the first slides I told you, the big breakthrough was 2012, the challenge on identifying the images. And 2012, it's yesterday. And in 3 years after that, the whole world was designing these deep networks and trying to analyze it, to analyze skin cancer and all kinds of things. So it is also going extremely fast, and it will have a significant impact on a large number of human activities and transform many jobs. For the first time, maybe some people compare it to the industrial revolution. One thing that is different is that maybe for the first time, it really addresses the industrial revolution, in some sense, having a machine that substitutes people in terms of physical power, physical strength. Now it is intellectual power, and that's a new aspect of it, which can be somewhat scary. So if you have a good view, we will say, and all this is probably true, it will help to have much better diagnosis in medicine. This is around the corner, that's certainly very good. It will help in having much faster search for case law. It will help for this displacement of people and goods along railways, certainly, freeways, maybe. Although the problem of the banana with the sticker is still around there, you have to remember that. It will help to have devices that help people to have fast access to relevant information, customer support, robots that can help, for instance, robots that help elderly people, they're making quite a lot of progress, identification of pathogens, development of new drugs, smart language assistance. This is only a small, short list. If you have a more concerned point of view, you can fear that there would be large destruction of some type of jobs, and that this will happen on a time scale which is quite fast, that the society will have hard time to adapt, because when there is a fast job destruction, you have to create new jobs, and that is also not so easy. And so you could look at each of these items there, and also have maybe a negative view. I was telling you, if you have, for instance, a displacement, sorry, if you have the displacement of people, or, I'm sorry, here it is. Displacement of people along freeways or goods, well, I told you about the problem of the trucks, for instance, that is certainly a loss of many jobs. The access to information, it is clear that the access to information has been developed a lot. At the same time, you also see that the information can be manipulated and you have spam. So you have customer support, but at the same time, you have profiling of people. I'm sure that really wants to profile to be hanging there in all these machines or not. You have robots that can help you, but you can also have robots that can become autonomous, that are able to make autonomous decisions about shooting or killing someone. That is another concern, of course. Rather than the future, I would like to talk about the present and a few words on AI in the political world. And that is something that is for me a major concern, which is the control of populations and the manipulation of information. Last week, actually, George Soros in Davos made a statement. I want to call attention to the mortal danger facing open societies from the instruments of control that machine learning and artificial intelligence can put in the hands of repressive regimes. And then he talks about China, where the rapidly expanding information available about the person is going to be consolidated in a centralized database to create a social credit system. And none of this is taking place. There are rankings of people where you gather all kinds of data about, from the financial bank record to how they behave on the street to if they post a political opinion and all kinds of things. And this can certainly be threatful. This is not only there. In 2018, in the last few months, Malaysia has equipped the police forces with face recognition devices. Singapore has an experimental program to equip every lamppost with a camera connected to a facial recognition facility and a crowd analytics software. Zimbabwe signed a deal with China to build a national image data basis. And as we all know, in the last 3 years, we have seen many examples of smart political manipulation of information. This, I will not enter that. It's much too touchy a subject. I leave it to the experts. To Robert Mueller, maybe, or I don't know. So it is clear that there is an urgent need for control mechanism. One needs to elaborate ethical rules. One needs to also develop a global vision on the possible impacts of AI on our societies. And that is certainly a big challenge in front of us. Henry Kissinger had this statement last year also, philosophically, intellectually, in every way, human society is unprepared for the rise of artificial intelligence. Kind of shares of opinion. Okay, I did not want to end my talk on these pessimistic remarks. And while preparing it yesterday, I realized that this was nearly the end of the talk and that I had something wrong. Because in every talk, there should be a joke. And it is very difficult. It's very difficult because a joke is something which is essentially cultural. It's a cultural marker. For me, I don't know anything about baseball. So half of the jokes that I listen to when I am in a conference, they are about baseball. I don't understand anything about that. So how can I make a joke? And so I was thinking about that, and I said, well, but unfortunately, because all this is artificial intelligence. So I will ask artificial intelligence. I went to the web, and of course,
Yeah.
I found on the web someone using deep networks to generate jokes. I said, okay, now I know. And so this is a Janet Shade who trained a database, who found a database of 43,000 jokes, fed a neural network with that, and asked the neural network to generate new jokes. And she decided to restrict a little bit, first of all, by forbidding the use of dirty words, let's say, so that you can present it at the conference, and restricting new jokes of the type, what do you call a dot dot dot, how do you, etc. And so here it is. Here is some of the ones that were generated by the neural network. Three jokes, quotation marks, many quotation marks. What did the new ant say after a dog? It was a pirate. And all the three are like that. They are not even grammatically correct. So they are, in some sense, they are so pathetic that they are hilarious. But the only message I can get from that is that we still have a long way to go. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Do we have questions?
Yes.
So when you talk about emergent complexity, and most people working on chaos theory and those sorts of things tend to believe that it's a very functional complexity of the network. What do you think is the biggest, and of course it's speculation, but what do you think is the biggest difference between what's going on with our deep networks right now and the brain, even of an infant? Obviously, if you knew that, you'd make billions, but what do you think is probably the biggest difference?
I think that in some sense what we are seeing these smart machines are dedicated at a single task. And so I think there are two differences. One is the fact that in the brain, and I was discussing the attitude of a baby playing and so on, the brain is used for many different activities, and they are all connected. That is, we have the reward of the game, of the play, of the draw, and so on. And all these are emotions which interact and which feedback the brain. And this is totally absent. This is nothing. In terms of more internal representation, the thing that we really don't understand is how the information is really processed inside these layers. I mean, how it is that this notion of emergence that I was showing before, it's really at its infancy. I mean, people are analyzing, technically they call it the cross entropy, that is a joint formation between an input and a layer and things like that, but we are extremely far from understanding all these things. So I think there is an enormous amount of work to do on that. And even on a simpler thing, which is understanding why the networks are able to learn, how is it even possible that you can teach that the network from a database of 100,000 images is able to fix 1 million parameters? It should be what we call in science overfitting. There are too many parameters. So if it is overfitting, it means that it should be just memorizing the data and not be able to generalize. Yet it generalizes. We are just, and in fact in this workshop taking place here, with the interactions of the physicists together with the computer scientists working in machine learning, trying to understand these aspects.
Since we've seen so many examples of how the physical systems struggle to outperform biological systems, how close do you think we are to starting to use actual biological systems to perform some of the tasks that are being failed with the physical computerized systems? Such as the human brain and some elements of the brain and the early studies on various neurological connections and what they are able to perceive and then how they can exponentially increase the data that they can process using some of that to perform some of what we're not able to do with the physical systems.
It is true that is one of the very fascinating aspects of what is taking place at this moment. That is, we have the revival of this neural network. This neural network, it is really a new paradigm. I was trying to explain why. It is because in a standard computer, you have processors. If you destroy one, then the computer does not work, and so on and so on. In a neural network, it's much more distributed. And it's like that in our brain also. In our brain, you have a dispersion of a few neurons. Actually, it happens to each of us every day. The brain still works. A bit less efficiently when you age, but still it works. And so this is really this idea that you have another way of processing information and of intelligence which is not there in the standard computer. And so this comeback of the neural network is something which is really interesting from this point of view. It goes back to how is it that we can use architecture based on these artificial neurons, that is very simple units that receive some information, process it just by the way to some and send it. How is it that we can use them to do sophisticated tasks? Now the fact that the first big successes are on vision and language, they are not the case. Even if I was careful to demonstrate to you that we are very far from having machines that are able to outperform our brains on all these tasks, but still we have mimicked a little bit the architecture of the brain, the V1, the root of the neural, and so on. We have designed some new machines based on that, and these new machines, guess what? The first task at which they are smart is vision and language. This is not the case.
So last year Google came up with one other program to add to the list of things that you showed, AlphaFold, to solve protein folding. And they outperformed many of the other conventional researchers on and the techniques for determining protein folding structures given an amino acid sequence. So going back to your question on the Newton's law example, as you said, the deep neural network doesn't necessarily provide you a generative model of what's happening. But is there a way for a physicist to look at the results of the, as you said, you know everything about the network. Is there a way to build Newton's laws without knowing it by just looking at the results of the network?
Well, this, first of all, it was a failed experiment, so I don't have it. I don't have the network that does it, so I cannot look at it. But it's interesting. That is, you can try to use these networks, train it, and once they are well trained, see how they behave. There's also a colleague that I met last week in San Diego is trying to train a network on the problem of quantum mechanics. That is, having a potential, one-dimensional potential, and
trying to get density, electronic density in this potential, okay, without teaching the quantum mechanics. Will the computer come up with the idea of the phase and the modulus of the wave function and so on? Probably not. Apparently, at the moment, it does not. But this is something that is interesting in itself. That is maybe in the end, these machines will also show us other ways of reasoning about pieces of science that we know. Let me come back to what you said about protein folding. I mean, protein folding, in some sense, we know what it is about. We know the rules of the game. I mean, it's basically electrostatics, and so we have to find a nice conformation. We know the energy function and so on. So, having the help of a computer to do that, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, I think it's just we've been helped by computers in order to do a lot of science. I mean, in the last few decades, it has been a major tool. And in this case, I think it would be an addition to something, a tool that is